एक मिनट, गेल्या होत्या, मी बघत नाही आहे. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sorry,
Yes.
disconnected.
Yes.
I'll just share my screen.
Once you are ready, then we will. We have also paused the live. Once you are ready, we can.
Yes, ma'am. You can.
Yes, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Sorry for the interruption. Something happened in between. I think that is a problem with the technology also. Sometimes. It's
true.
And
thank you.
Absolutely fine. There are always hiccups in entrepreneurships. So you should be able to take up these hiccups and start again without losing your interest and efforts. So that is again a big learning to all of us. So I was telling about my education that I did polymer engineering from MIT. As I said, as I mentioned that I'm living my childhood dream because when somebody would ask me, Dipti, what you want to become, I would say I want to become something like my father. And since my father started paint company around 41 years back, paint is a polymer actually. So that is, see, this is the main thing that whenever you start your own business or whenever you want to become an entrepreneur, you have to have a formal education or a technical background of that particular business. That is very important because all other aspects can be learned or understood later. But having core competence in your own area of expertise is very important. So that is why I did polymer engineering and then I did MBA marketing. The reason I'll tell you later for doing MBA. When I graduated engineering, I got a very good score in university. Actually, I was one of the toppers in the university. And that time I thought that, okay, now this is it, that I'm done. And I was on cloud nine, thinking that the grass is greener and I would join my father. That time my father said, no, you are not joining now. This is not the right time for you to join. You take some experience outside and then you come with some value addition. I didn't realize the importance of that and I didn't understand the word value addition. I said, what does it mean? But since he didn't allow me to join our own company, I started applying for jobs and I got a job in Garware Waldrops. Now it is known as Garware Technical Fibers. So Garware is basically world's second largest rope manufacturing company. So they manufacture polymer ropes, even yarns and the fishing nets. Or even the sports nets. So they're a big company, renowned company founded by late respected Abbasaheb Garware, who brought a plastic industry in India, who started first plastic industry in India. So he was pioneer in plastic industry in India. So I got an opportunity to work with that company as a graduate engineer trainee after my engineering. And when I was working in production, I was the only girl working in production on shop floor and that was a great experience. I mean, that is also one of the great learnings. And I mean, on my first day, I realized that even workers know better than me. So I was just holding a degree of engineering with good marks, with good score and this thing, but I was not knowing anything about polymer technology. I was even not knowing how to start a machine, how to start an extrusion machine. In fact, I was in my first time, I was seeing big machines making polymer ropes and yarns and weaving yarns and all these things. So that is a big thing that I was I learned that one should have good technical knowledge, not just a degree in hand. And while working in production department, I realized that I was not knowing anything about marketing. Or I was not knowing anything about business. I was not knowing even debit, credit. What is debit? What is credit? Because as an engineer, we were not taught anything of these commerce related things or economics. So whenever marketing team members used to come on the shop floor, they used to approve, sometimes they used to say that, okay, this quality is approved by our customer, you can dispatch this material. So we being technical, I used to feel that they are dominating us. Why? Because they are knowing the market, they are knowing the customer. So they basically know what customer wants, and that is how they can take decisions. So that was the time when I realized that, yes, now I should do MBA, that too with marketing specialization. So after working in Garare Waldorf for around 1 year, I did MBA marketing from Sinhagad Institute of Management. So that was two years full-time course I did from MBA, Sinhagad Institute. And then after graduating from Sinhagad Institute, I said, now I will take job on my own merit. And I got opportunity to work with Jotun Paints. It was my campus placement that time. And Jotun is a European paint manufacturing company. And they are very well known for even marine coating applications. They are in Dubai, Abu Dhabi, they have got a good base for decorative paints. So that was a good opportunity to work with Jotun. But that time I wanted to work in marketing, but the company didn't allow females to work in marketing. So then I left that company and I got opportunity to work with world's largest paint company, which is PPG. That time it was PPG India. So PPG is world's largest paint company, and the main advantage of this company is you name the product and they have it. So it is nothing that in any paint technology they do not have any product, be it a metal, plastic, wood, composites, glass, anything. So I joined them in Chennai. And that was also a good experience because I was interviewed over phone, and then they asked that we do not have any office or any presence in Pune, and we have our head office in Chennai. So would you be interested in joining our head office in Chennai? And with, of course, permission from my parents, I joined them in Chennai, and I worked in Chennai. When I started working in PPG, I mean, Chennai was like a completely foreign land to me. I was not knowing language, no acquaintances there. So the food was different, people were different, language was different, everything was different. Entire, it is like you are living in a foreign land, even though you are in India. But that was again a good experience because then I learned Tamil because of that. So I can speak Tamil. So today they are celebrating Pongal. So that is why I said Pongal Nalvaratrikal. So it was a good experience working with PPG. One more thing I would like to mention here that as a beginner, we all have to do shagirdi. Shagirdi karni padti hai. Shagirdi karni padti hai, ne, you have to do whatever job is given to you to learn. So these are your formative years after graduation, after college. So learn from every experience, every opportunity what you get. And when I joined PPG, of course, I was in the marketing department, but since I was a fresher in marketing, first assignment they gave me was making New Year diaries for the company. And I felt that what is big deal in making diaries? I mean, it's just like you put a name on it. But then when I worked with their US team, then I realized that there is something called branding department. There are brand managers, and you are not supposed to use your company logo just like that. So there are different regulations or specifications to use company logo. So these are different things which I learned, and of course they helped me when I joined my father. When I joined our company, it definitely helped me. So when we made our company diaries, I was knowing how to make a company diary. So as a beginner, we should never deny taking up any job or any responsibility, because it's always learning from those experiences. Then I was really fortunate enough to get some technical training in some companies outside India. Like I got training from Germany. There is a big company called BYK. So I got training for additives in BYK. Then we were developing some new products. With that connection, I got to go to China and Taiwan and learn the technology, bring it to India, and then we started manufacturing those products when I joined our own organization. And of course, Japan was a different experience altogether. It was a lifetime experience, I always say, and I'm going to share about it in coming slides. Then I joined my father in 2010 after taking experience outside for almost 1.5-2 years in different companies and different roles. So now my job was to be the change maker as a second generation entrepreneur. Let me tell you, it's always difficult to start your own company or enterprise and be a first generation entrepreneur. There are different challenges you face, but it is equally challenging and difficult to join as a second generation entrepreneur. The reason I'll tell you is, when Abhishek Bachchan joined film industry, everyone had very high expectations from him because they were knowing Amitabh Bachchan. So people will always test your knowledge, your abilities, capabilities, your expertise when you join as a second generation entrepreneur. And of course, my previous experience helped me when I joined our own organization. Again, I would tell you that MBA also helps you to polish your skills. So communication skills, like not only communication with your customers or suppliers, it's really communication with your own associates, employees, workers. That is also equally important, because in business, communication is the key. So good communication will definitely lead to a growth of a company. So that helps. So MBA is definitely polishing your skills, but the core competence or knowledge comes from your basic educational background. So I was telling about the second generation entrepreneur, that when I joined my father, everyone had different expectations. They were really skeptical whether this girl would able to do it or not. And team was like old, because when our company started, many of them had joined that time itself. So they were associated with company for more than 35 years. And they had seen me as a child. So that was again a big challenge to prove yourself. But definitely, when I feel that whenever you give respect, things happen swiftly. Because even to workers or everyone, we got so many things to learn from them. And that is why whenever we have that approach, working together as a family with your team members, then that really helps a lot. So so I joined as a second generation entrepreneur. Now I would like to tell you about two case studies, or two success stories, I would say, about the two products which we developed after I joined the company. So we had good opportunity at helmet manufacturing company. And they were manufacturing helmets, around 2000 helmets per day. So that time the technology was different. They were painting the helmets and baking it at around 70 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. And then that is how the paint would dry. Now they came up with an option that, can you develop UV curable coating? I always say that UV curable coating is nothing but a magic product. I'm sorry, my computer has...
Yes, madam, we have made you co-host.
Sorry for the trouble, but there was some problem in the computer.
No problem. It's okay, ma'am. It's okay. So over to you, ma'am. We will again now.
Yes. I was just mentioning about the development of UV curable coatings. When you are working as an entrepreneur, you should understand the unmet needs of the customer and the changing environment, because we are the change maker. So we need to foresee the future, what is required by the market, what our customer needs, and then you can develop a product or a technology to suit to make it suitable for the changing environment. And that is how we developed this UV curable coatings. I will share the video with you. You can see how helmet is painted.
Really amazing.
So this is a robotic painting. This is a robotic painting which is done at customer's end. And now, why I call this UV curable coating as a magic product is, the reason is it dries within 3 to 4 seconds under UV radiation. So you know how X-ray is taken. So when X-ray is taken, we don't understand the rays entering our body and taking a scan. So the same way UV rays, ultraviolet rays in that particular wavelength, they fall on the painted surface and they cure the paint. So this process happens in just 3 to 4 seconds. And how does it happen? Now you see the next video. So when helmet comes in front of those lamps, they are nothing but lamps. UV curable coating lamps are there. They are mercury lamps. And they the radiation of those lamps is into that particular wavelength where ultraviolet rays are there. So this is called radiation curing technology. So with this, you have seen that when helmet comes in front of those lamps, it rotates for some time, hardly 3-4 seconds. And during that time, curing happens and paint is completely dried. After that, you can bang the helmet on the floor and nothing happens. So it is that much tough film it is formed. You can scratch it. There are no marks coming on it. So this is the technology which we developed. So I went to China and Taiwan to develop this technology. There were really many hiccups in this particular development, because the first was we were not able to meet the quality standards of that particular customer and the formulation. So we were trying it for more than a year and we were not able to achieve good results. The paint was not drying at all. And we had procured a material worth few lakhs, and it was not, we were not able to liquidate that. Then I visited China and Taiwan with this particular problem, or with this particular development, I would say. I worked with the chemists there in Taiwan and got to learn how to process this product. in the right way and the chemistry of it. And then we, after coming back, we developed this technology in-house in our own company. And then we started supplying to this particular customer. So it was a very crucial time of around 1.5 years that we were not able to succeed. And we were still trying to develop that. But we had a gut feel that definitely we can do it one or the other day. And that really happened. So for last more than 10 years, we have been supplying to this particular customer. And we are really proud to say so. So this is how technology develop, technological development happens. Sometimes you have really failures in the say process, but one should not get bogged down by the difficulties, and we should keep trying. The way we are trying to connect, reconnect, reconnect right now. So we have to understand changing needs of the customer. We have to give some value addition to the customer. See, as I told, if that particular manufacturer was producing 2000 helmets per day with the conventional technology of baking for 30 minutes. Now, with this particular new technology, they are manufacturing more than 40,000 helmets per day. So from 2000 helmets per day to 40,000 helmets per day, it's an exponential increment in the production volumes. And that gives the cost reduction. So we will be coming to that point later. But because of automation, because of technological advantage, advancements, we can really do wonders. And that is, and we are the change makers. So we, it is our responsibility to take initiative and make this development happen. And again, one more thing I would proudly say that this was one of the projects for Make in India, because that time nobody was producing this product in India and we could do it 10 years back. So this is how technological advancements happen. As an entrepreneur, we should also foresee the future. What does it mean? That now you can understand that more than 15 years back, people were using pagers, the small device to just text each other. And that was very costly. And of course, very few people had it. But with the advancement of mobile phones, pagers were out of the market. Or even you can say Nokia phones. Nokia is the best example of not being proactive in a technological advancement. Because I remember when I was doing engineering, I have used phones 3310, Nokia 3310, Nokia 3315. Those were small handsets with buttons on it and just used to make calls and send some text messages. Very few, that messages also had a limitation over words. But when Apple and Samsung came into the market, Nokia couldn't keep the pace with the technology, and they were wiped out of the market. So even iPods were invented by Apple, and with technological advancements in phone itself, we are no more using iPods to listen music. So even CDs, compact discs, were used in a large scale to store data. But now advancement in the flash drives and USB drives and so many upgraded technological devices, we are no more using compact discs. There was a product which was used on compact disc also, which was a lacquer, transparent clear coat, which used to prevent the CD from getting scratches. But because CDs were evaded out of the market, there was no market for the coating also for CDs. So that is how market needs change, people's choices change, the requirements matter a lot. And that is how we need to change as an entrepreneur. So we need to upgrade ourselves, change the technology, keep the pace with the technological developments. Now, I would like to share with you the next revolutionary product, I would say, about that is the water-based technology. So I'm sharing the screen. So this is the product. I would give the brief introduction before that. The paint is a chemical. So chemicals are always hazardous to the health and environment. So human health is also at risk whenever we are using paints. See, whenever you paint your house, if you're not using water-based paints, if you're using solvent-based paint, so then they, you don't feel like staying in that room till that the smell is gone or the particular peculiar smell is there. So that is because of the solvents or resins which are used in the paint. So basically paint is a mixture made out of chemical, hazardous chemicals when it is solvent-based paints. So as I said, it is hazardous to human health because they are carcinogenic in nature. They have skin irritation to your eyes, and of course equally hazardous to the environment. So as a social responsibility, we need to work on the development of green technology products, and that is the need of the hour. So considering the taking that into the consideration or keeping that in mind, what we did is we developed water-based paints for industrial applications. See, basically industrial paints are used where first objective to paint particular component is the protection and then the aesthetics. So we have to protect a component, say for example engine or any structure from rusting. So corrosion is main, corrosion resistant paint are important. Then weather resistance is important, chemical resistance is important. So in industrial segment, developing water-based paint was equally a challenging job because we have to take care of different properties which are already there in the solvent-based paints. And that is how we started working on the water-based development. We were the first one, we are the pioneer in India to develop this green technology product. The advantage of this particular product is these are eco-friendly paints. So what does it mean? With the use of this particular product, we can reduce the air pollution by 98%. And that is the biggest advantage, because when painter is painting a component for minimum of 5 or 6 hours a day, he's exposed to hazardous chemicals, and that is hazardous to his health. So when water-based paint is used, there are very few health hazards, like very mere, hardly any health hazards. And that is how his life can be increased. So this is a noble cause we work for. So we are the pioneer in India to develop water-based paints for industrial applications. We developed this technology in 2012, within a very short span of 3 to 4 months. And we got this product approved from Cummins for diesel engines. That is why I showed you the video of this product. So this application is being done today also at Cummins plant in Fulton. And these are water-based paints. So they are not hazardous to the environment and human health. So this is something which we are always proud to mention, that we could develop a product which was approved by USMNC. They started using this product, and completely they switched over from solvent-based to water-based technology in 2012. Till today, we are supplying this. So it was definitely a challenge, along with the opportunity, of course, but it was a challenge to develop such products and meet customer requirements, because when we are working for MNCs like Cummins or these big companies, they have very stringent quality standards to be met, and the specifications are really very strict. So we have to follow all the norms and make the product suitable for their line conditions also, and meet quality standards. So we could definitely do that, and make in India again could happen because of this. Till today, we are facing challenge of procuring the raw material, because after post-pandemic, importing raw material is a big challenge, because there are a lot of restrictions on the movement of material across globe. And with this product, we could make in India. That is why we could supply to Cummins, and their production was not stopped because of we making it in, manufacturing it in India. So that is how the entrepreneurship, I feel, is important. And we are the change makers. So we can really do wonders if we really take our roles seriously. And as a social responsibility, I feel we should always look at sustainable solutions which we manufacture, or any service which we provide. So this sustainability aspect should be kept in mind. So this is about the technological advances I told you. And now I'll be sharing with you as I said, a lifetime experience which I had. So this is nothing but I got an opportunity to go to Japan for a training program, Toyota Production System. And why I'm saying it was a lifetime experience, because you know Japanese people for different many things. Like Japan means they are perfectionists. Japanese means they are perfectionists. They are punctual. They are patriotic. And I could experience all of this in a very short span of 15 days when I was there in Japan. So that, I mean, going to Japan and staying there and getting this training was like, it changed me as an individual, personally and professionally both. So it was definitely a lifetime experience, I call it. So it was actually a scholarship received by Toyota Motors, Japan, and Japanese government to undergo a course, a training program in Toyota Production System. So we had a group of, I mean, there were participants from all across globe, from 9 different countries, and 22 participants were there. And I was the only girl in the entire group. So it was a different experience working with different people all across globe and from different industries also. So it was a great learning experience within the team, within the group we had. In just 15 days, it was like a family bonding with all of them. And of course, getting trained from Japanese people was definitely a learning experience. So I visited Toyota Tahara plant. So Tahara plant is basically the largest in all Toyota plants in Japan. And area of that particular plant is 37 million square meter. It's a huge, huge manufacturing site and on the banks of Southern Sea. So this Tahara plant basically manufactures models like Lexus, RC, RCF, 4Runner, and Land Cruiser. So you can see all these luxury models are being manufactured in Tahara plant. They manufacture 790 vehicles per day. 790 vehicles per day. That is the rate of production Tahara plant is manufacturing. And just with 7,320 employees. So the strength of employees is 7,320, and they are manufacturing 790 vehicles. 700 workers per shifts are working, and working shifts is not 8 hours. See that this is the Japanese perfection or accuracy, I would say, 7.40 hours. So that is how the working hours are. In India, if you ask how much, what are the time shift working shifts or timing, people would say 8 hours. Out of 8 hours, how many hours we do, just time pass, we don't know. So that is how Tahara plant is working. Now, at Tahara plant, one vehicle, can you believe, one vehicle is manufactured or assembled in 72 seconds. And that was something mind-boggling. I mean, I could not imagine myself. I was actually on the shop floor, and just in few seconds, one vehicle was getting assembled. So it was not completely robotic. It was robotic plus manual assembly line. And there are more than 30,000 parts are assembled in one vehicle. Just imagine 30,000 parts are assembled with robotic and manual both assembly line, and one vehicle is assembled in 72 seconds. You just imagine how fast, the speed of technology, how fast this all process must be happening. And I'm fortunate to experience it actually online of Toyota. So there are 1,900 items for pre-delivery inspection. And one more thing, they carry only 1 day inventory. Inventory means the stock. So raw material and FG, finished goods, they carry only 1 day. So Japanese people work on just-in-time principle. And that is how the cost matters. Then Toyota's finished good yard has a capacity to store 40,000 vehicles, 40. They are manufacturing 790 vehicles per day. And they are able to store, and the yard is so big that they can store 40,000 vehicles. And every day they have many export consignments. So ships are loaded from the sea. So 5,000 vehicles are loaded on each ship for export. And the best thing I would say about the perfection or accuracy of Japanese people is the last point, the distance between two vehicles. When they are loaded on the on the ship, the two vehicles are adjacent to each other, ahead of each other, right? So distance between two vehicles in the ship is just 10 centimeter from front and 30 centimeter from side. So you will see all vehicles lined up in such a manner that only 10 centimeter from front is the distance, 30 centimeter from the sides in two vehicles. So that is the example of perfection and accuracy what Japanese people have. So their drivers are so trained, and that is how they can load 5,000 vehicles in one particular ship, because they can park those vehicles in such a small distance. Now I'll be coming to TPS. TPS means Toyota Production System. So the excuse me. What is the logic of TPS? Now see, you are all, most of you are commerce graduates, or you are studying BCom. So if anyone would ask, what is the selling price? You would say cost plus profit, because this is my cost of the product to manufacture the product or to give a service. And then the profit margin, I want minimum 15% margin, minimum 20% margin to survive. And then my selling price becomes this much. Then this is logic of loser. You are going to definitely lose in the market because there is fierce competition in the market. So then you would say, okay, my selling price is X minus my cost is equal to profit. Then in this, what you are doing is you are compromising on your profit. And if you're compromising on your profit, it is a question of your survival, because if you are not able to get good profit from your business, then you may not be able to survive as a company. Then what logic of TPS says is selling price, which is of course determined by market because of competition, minus profit, because profit has to be there, which is decided by the top management that in order to survive or run the show, I want this much profit so that I can pay salaries of my employees, I can pay bills, I can pay taxes, all this. So in for that, I need this much margin. Margin means profit. So that is already determined by top management. And then selling price minus profit is equal to cost. And that is the logic which is followed by TPS. So, and what is the cost is that is to be managed by the company. So that is our job, how to manufacture a product or how to sell a service in minimum cost. And the control over cost is in our hands. So finally, what it says is, logic of TPS is quality products at low cost with timely delivery. Because if you can deliver on time, your cost of inventory is coming down. So this is the logic of TPS. So definitely it was a lifetime experience to visit Toyota, learn these things. This is our group. So we were all 22 participants from different countries in India. From India, myself and and one more person from Bangalore, Mr. Rao, he was with me. So it was a different experience going to Toyota Japan and going to Toyota plant and learning, get very good insights of the organization. Now I'm coming to the last point of the discussion, is the key aspects of business. The key aspects of business today and tomorrow. I always say that innovation is the key recipe. Innovation is a key ingredient in the recipe of success. Innovation is the key ingredient in the recipe of success. So innovation is the mantra, because if Steve Jobs wouldn't have innovated Apple or iPhone or Apple products, then we wouldn't have got used to it. So innovation is the basic thing which any entrepreneur should look at in order to make the enterprise successful to grow. Then globalization. Globalization means, see, this is an opportunity because previously globalization was not there. Because of the internet and government policies, globalization is there now. But that is also come up with different challenges that competition is there. You have a fierce competition because your business, even if it is local, you are global. So you have a global reach to do business. So when competition is there, you have a lot of pressure on the cost. And that is why I gave the logic of TPS. So you have to control costs to maintain the profits and to survive in the market. So there is tremendous pressure on the costing or pricing of the product. Hello?